Hello, everybody, and welcome to our late appearance here on our Wednesday Facebook Live. We were experiencing a little bit of technical difficulties, so it took us a few minutes to come in this afternoon. We had everything set up, thought we were good to go, went to air. I was chatting along, and then we realized that we weren't live. So hopefully we are live now and you can see us. So as you come in, let us know that yes, you can see us and the sound, whether the sound is good or bad. If there's anything else that we need to change. And again, I apologize for the delay today, but you know, that's what happens when you go live. Things happen. I'm just going to take a peek at my cell phone here and see if I can see the live stream so that I'm not talking to myself again. And it looks like all they're seeing, Bill, from what I can see, is the Wirecast thing. I don't know if it's refreshed yet or not. So let me know if you can see us. There it goes. It came up. So looking good. Hey, Roxanne. Thanks. Okay. You just never know. You know, you have to kind of go in and hope that it's doing what it's supposed to do, because as you know, technology loves to play games with you. It's like Murphy was in the room today. And if you know who Murphy is, you've had those days where he's with you too. So we are going to continue working on the cornice board that we put together last week. We finished up the antique office chair and we built the frame of the cornice board. So you remember me upholstering the insides of this with the lining material and then assembling the cornice board into a unit. So today we're hopefully going to get some fabric on here. So I have pulled out all the various tools that I need to do this project. But as I'm getting started and showing you what we've got for tools, go ahead and hit the share button if you would and share this with your friends and family so they can hop on over and have some fun with us too. It's always fun to have a bigger crowd and have everybody joining in the conversation. I love all the questions. So as you're watching too, we really encourage you to go ahead and ask any questions that you might have, whether it's in regards to what I'm working on now or something else on the upholstery and soft home deck field. So let me go ahead and show you what I've pulled out for my tools and supplies. I've got cardboard tack strip, which I'm sure if you've made cornice boards before, you've used that for those. Got my yardstick because I need to draw out my design here. I've gone ahead and pre-cut some of my Dacron pieces just to save time on camera. So this Dacron that I'm using today is a 1/2 ounce Dacron. I typically like the 1 ounce, but the supplier sent me a roll of the wrong item and I've just been working my way through it until I can get the thicker. So this is a little bit thinner than I usually use, but it works just fine. It's just my preference. I've pre-made all my cording and I am using an actual full 1/4 inch cording for this project instead of the typical 5/32 or 6/32, which is what I usually use for the project. So I'm using a full 1/4 inch cording. I've got my first piece of fabric there. I've got my scissors, my pullers, my staple gun. And in the center of this cornice, when it's finished, it gets some buttons. So I've made up, because I haven't decided which one I want to use yet. So I have made up 3 different buttons here until I decide which one's actually going to be the one on this. And we've done a little cute thing here so that we can actually change the buttons out on this. And I'll show you that a little bit later. So the first thing I need to do is go ahead and mark out my design. I don't know how well you can see this on the camera, but if you remember, we had the design that forms like triangles forming together in the center. So I've got to draw that out because when I pad it, I'm going to be padding each section individually so that I don't have padding under certain elements that I need. So let me go ahead and get that drawn out. And I had predetermined that I wanted this design to start 1.5 inches up from the bottom and 1.5 inches down from the top of my cornice board. So I have gone ahead and marked that part already just because it's awkward to mark the ends. I figured it was easier on camera to have that already done. So I have my little reference points on each of my sides here. And what I need to do is connect those dots to give me that triangular formation that I'm looking for. So I'm gonna go ahead. Like I said, I've already used the little ruler to do the 1.5. So this is just connecting my points. And I'm going to use a Sharpie so that I can see it through my Dacron and make sure I get everything stapled where I need it. So I'll get the diagonal in this direction. And I'll throw the ruler around while I'm here, just to give you a little noise to listen to. And then mark the other direction here. So how many of you have made cornice boards before And have you done multiple fabrics on cornice boards or just the individual fabric? What have you done? And what are you working on? So here you can see that I have drawn, well, maybe you can't see the, can they see that, Bill? The Sharpie? Yeah, I can see it if I hold it up a little closer. So here you can see I've drawn the intersecting points that I need. So that center, I'm going to pre-drill a hole in there for when I apply the button at the end. So let's go ahead and get that pre-drilled. Go ahead and get my drill in place. And it went through. So yes, there will be a little hole in my lining fabric, but only I will see that it's there. So I just went ahead and I pre-drilled that. And then later it'll be easy for me to find that hole when I need it. So I'm going to do things probably a little different than you have typically done when you've done a cornice board. That I am going to start with the piece of fabric that will actually come up into the back area. So when I make cornice boards, I have a piece of finished fabric that goes up into the back area, usually about 3 inches. And that measurement will change depending on the projection of the cornice. Because the further out that your cornice projects from the wall, the higher you need that finished fabric on the inside to be so that it doesn't show. I mean, obviously there's certain places, if you're standing in a room, you're gonna see that there's lining up in there. So don't like lose any sleep over this, but you know, you do wanna have a little bit of the decorator fabric on the inside of your cornice. So I've got, so the white background is the side that we're using for this fabric. Although the other side's pretty too. It's just not quite enough of a finished stitch to use it though. So I'm gonna go ahead and actually get my center marked. I know I have more fabric than I need here, but if you don't mark your center, sometimes you will find you are off and wish you had. So what's everybody working on out there, and how many cornice, what have you done for cornice boards? Looking for comments here. So let me get my, okay. So 14 and 3/4, so right about there is my center. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to attach this with a cardboard tack strip. Now you've probably done cornice boards, if you've done them, you've probably done them where you bring the fabric from the front to the back. Let me move this so you can see it better. You've probably done it where you bring it from the front to the back and you top staple it and then you cover it with some sort of a gimp. So this is a way to avoid having to do that. So I want this bumped up about 2.5 inches from the edge. And then that way I'll end up with like about a three inch strip of fabric on the back. So that's good there. I'm gonna go ahead and get one staple in here. 2.5. I don't know if you can see the measurements on the ruler, but. So I'm just getting this in position. 2.5 and keeping it taut. And I'm going to do the same up around the legs. Okay. There we go. And again over on this leg. So this is just holding it in position right now until I can get that cardboard tack strip on there. Just adding a few staples underneath saves you from having to grow a third arm. All right, so here is my cardboard. My cardboard is gonna go all the way up and around, making sure I've got a big enough piece. I cut off 2 pieces because we're gonna need a second piece for the next step that we do. Yeah, so that's plenty. All right, so I'm gonna go ahead and get that stapled on here. And I won't talk at you while I staple because I know you won't be able to hear me. So go ahead and get this. Now, one thing when you're making cornice boards. This is a half inch plywood that I'm using for the face of this cornice board. If you're using anything thinner, you want to just watch out that your staples aren't so long that they're going to go through to the opposite side of your cornice board. There's nothing worse than having your cornice board done and realizing you can feel all those little staples through there. Ask me how I know. I actually upholstered a a vinyl board that we use on the top of our workhorses for some projects when I'm raising them up on the workhorses. Gives me a flat surface. And I didn't pay attention to the length of my staple, so when I put it back on and was all done with it, I realized that I could feel the bumps of some of the staples. So one of these days I will take that apart and get a new piece of vinyl at that point. Tear that end off. And now I am just going to bring this down and around to the front. And that will work fine. And I just actually want to take off some of this excess before I do that, because I'm going to finish off these edges at the same time. So hello, Sheila. Hello, Roxanne. Hello, Lori. Hi, Phyllis. Hello, Rhonda. Hey, Jane. And hello, Amy. And hello, Bonnie. Hello, Annette. A lot of you are popping in now, huh? Hello, Kathy. And hey, Bob. Hi, Kim. Looks like you guys are all joining us here. So I'm going to remind you again to go ahead and hit that share button to share this out there with your friends. And let me know what projects you're working on. And if you've done cornice boards before, I'm just curious how many of you are totally new to the cornice board and how many of you have done these before and are just looking for different methods. Okay, so Lori says, I've never done a cornice, but have always liked them. So this is very cool. Taking a break from doing a cushion. Ah, Phyllis is working on a bedspread. Let's see, Rhonda says, I'm working on springtime, the settee. Oh, fun. All right, so I'm going to trim some of this back. I just need enough to fold under to have a clean edge. Okay, so Annette, you've made many, many cornice boards, all different sizes. Yeah, cornice boards in the window treatment world are definitely popular. New Englanders, though, I tell you, people in the New England area have much more plain tastes and designs than some of the people further down south than we are, or even out west. All right, so now I'm going to bring this down and around. I'm actually going to bring it around and staple it to the front. So let me get a couple staples started and then I'll turn it so you can see it. And I know before I hadn't shown you where the different fabrics were going, so now you get to see where they're all going to be placed and how they interplay with one another. They're definitely bright and cheery. So let's see, you know what? I am a little bit shy right here. Oh, I've got to make an adjustment. So let me go ahead and do that. Just at that very corner, I didn't have quite the depth I needed. I didn't plan for that extra diagonal there. So let me just pop a couple here. So what I'm going to do is just shift that end. There's some fillers. Looking to see if there were any questions here while I fix this little. So Christine says, I'm with Lori. I'd like to see the basics of making the box to begin the project. So if you want to see the box portion on our episode 28, which was last week, we finished up the antique office chair. And then at the end of that episode, we put this together. So if you want to go back and watch that live feed, because they're all recorded, so it's right here in the Facebook, so that you can watch that. Let me see how much I need. Yeah, not much. All right. So So I'm going to have to shift these two corners. Actually, you know what? It's going to be easier just to take this off. Let me do that. See, you do have to sometimes take things apart and readjust. Here I had counted. I cut this strip 5 inches and thought I calculated right, but forgetting that there's that diagonal at the corners. So we will go ahead and fix that. So that diagonal adds 1/4 inch, which was just enough to throw me off. Or not even quite 1/4 inch, but... but that's what they make staple pullers for, right? And I will clean up all these staples later. Yeah, staples get everywhere when you do upholstery. You have them all over the place. So I'm going to bump it down to 2 inches instead of 2.5, which will give me what I need. Sorry for the squeaky noise of my pullers here. And if I had been smart before I filled this in, I would have checked it once, which is what I usually do. I usually get a few staples in, then check and make sure it's going to pull, but I checked the center and I didn't check that corner. Oops. Squeaky. Plywood hangs onto the staples pretty well, though. So Patty says, always looking for new and better ways to do things, working on panels for sliding glass doors. I'm actually quoting a job for panels on sliding glass doors. Panels are not my favorite thing to do. Especially sliding glass doors. They get to be really big. You're working with multiple widths, typically. I feel like with panels, it's just they're cumbersome and you just feel like you're constantly doing this job and it takes a while before all of a sudden you feel like, you know, you've gotten somewhere with that type of work. I tell you, these pullers, I don't know what you use for pullers in your workroom, but these Osborne 120.5 pullers, they're the best for getting underneath the edge of the staples and lifting them up. They really are well worth the investment. So let me make sure I got that where you can see. So I'm just taking these out because I want to bump this thing down. We're almost there. Only got a few more staples to go.
You make mistakes.
I do make mistakes. Bill said, you make mistakes? Yep, I do. A lot of times I'll cut things really generous and go big so that I don't have to worry about something like this. But with this fabric, it was a little bit on the expensive side, and I ordered just enough to do the two cornice boards with not much leeway. So I didn't cut these strips extra long, which sometimes I would do. And that's when you're measuring to do your upholstered furniture, I give myself generous amounts for my pulls, because if you need to shift one way or the other because of the way the pattern is and you didn't plan your center right or something, or just when you get there, it seems like it needs more than you thought it did, it's better off to do that. So it gives yourself, I'd rather waste a couple inches of fabric than have to recut something. And this is one of those situations where I didn't listen to myself and I didn't order a lot of extra fabric. So we will be using, not only are we going to be using cardboard tack strip, which luckily I brought my roll out here because that piece is a mess now. We're actually going to be using curvies on this cornice board too. And I don't know if we'll get that far today. It's possible. But we're going to be using curvies to create that design. This fabric hides the staples pretty well. So I'm going to shift it down. Oops, didn't come all the way out. You can feel the leg of a staple poking up here. Get that out of there. So many times, you know, members and students that take my workshops will get really frustrated because they feel like they take out as many staples as they put back in. And that is just part of the process. Kim, you make us feel human. Errors to by me and the expert too. Yeah, we all make mistakes. None of us are infallible. But yeah, it's like, don't get frustrated, because that's part of the learning process too. And you know, it's like sometimes you're doing something in your mind somewhere else, and mistakes will happen then too. It's like, it's better to try to be focused on what you're doing and not work on a project if your mind is elsewhere. Because oftentimes I find if I do that, I end up having more difficult a time. And sometimes you just need to walk away and come back, and then everything will start going just right. So let's remeasure this. So I'm going to go 1.5 this time for a total measurement, just so I have plenty of fabric. So I got that positioned. And I've already trimmed it, so now I have to be careful and make sure I've got it right so that I've got enough at both ends. Come on, you. Yep, so I do that way. All right, so now I can bump it up. So if I go 1 inch and then the cording strip is 1/2 inch, or the cardboard tack strip is 1/2 inch, that'll give me my 1.5, so. And this time, we'll check it before we put that cardboard tack strip on all the way. And I got plenty around my edge. But you see, it didn't take much time to pull that out either, so it's better to do it right and leave it and wish you had done it differently later. So now let's check this. Going 1.5, 1.5. There, that gives me around the corners. And we'll use this piece and get a new piece for the next part. So I am just going to go ahead and reattach the same way we did it the first time. Get my cardboard tack strip on there. So does anybody have any questions while I'm working? And this is a situation too, where obviously with a cornice board, you don't have to have your staples so close together doing this as you would if it was a piece of furniture, because once this is up in the window, nobody's going to be poking at it, or at least you hope they aren't. Nobody should be hanging from the window treatments. Although my new kittens decided that they've tried that a couple times. We have draperies in our dining room that are, I don't know, probably 6 inches from the ceiling, and we have 10-foot ceilings, and they go all the way to the floor. Actually, maybe a little further from the ceiling. And one day I walked into the dining room, and I could hear a funny noise, and I look up, and there's one of my brand new kittens sitting on top of the rod, peeking over the top like, "Hi, Mom, here I am." And trying to get her down was quite the task. It was easier to just kind of give her a minute to come down on her own, because I think if I had kept pestering her, she would have destroyed everything. But other than it, cats, hopefully nobody's hanging on your window treatments. So Phyllis says, what is a panel for a sliding glass door? We're talking drapery panels, Phyllis. So it would be
a curtain.
So it would either be like a pinch pleat drape or something that hangs over your sliding glass doors and runs on a rod. So that's what we're talking about. Okay, now let's try pulling this to the bottom. And as you can see, this fabric definitely frays, so you get threads everywhere. All right, so I'm gonna pull it to the front now, get a couple staples. So see, this way, this time I'm down quite a bit further, but I'd rather be that way than fighting with it. Come up towards the corner. Get this down. Keeping that folded neat there. This one from down here. Okay, just need to re-angle this so I can get a good grip, because I'm trying to pull it and smooth it out around the corner here. I may have to make a little snip in there to do that. I'm just trying to relieve the stress on that corner. There you go, that worked. Sometimes just a little clip is all it takes to get the things to lay smooth. And I'm just trying to make a fold here. Okay, now this all gets covered up by my face of the cornice board when I put the face fabric on. Okay, let's go ahead and do the other end, and there's that end. And I like the fact that this gives me a clean, nice edge on the inside without having to go over it again with a decorative gimp or something. But some shapes you just can't do this with too, so you're not always going to be able to use this method. With curved cornice bottoms, you wouldn't be able to do this. You'd have to do it a little differently. Make my clip here. Okay, my points of my scissors all seem to be dull half the time. There we go, pull that down. Get my fold back into place here. Okay, so now finish filling this in with staples. And there you can see that's the inside of our cornice board. And again, this is getting more layers over it, so I don't need a ton of staples here. So what I just did was stapled along, pulled it up so you can see, stapled along here to pull it down. So now what I'm going to do is we're going to put our cording on here. I think this one was the one that was big enough for here. Yep. All right, so this is my decorative cording that goes at the bottom of my cornice board, making sure again I've got plenty at both ends to get around the corner. And I bet at this point you're going, how the heck is she doing this, right? Because this is not the way you typically see this done. And I contemplated on whether to put the green cording at the bottom or not, and you'll see why later. And I decided that it looked good. I sent a picture out to a couple people and said, hey, okay, give me your opinion, yay or nay, on the bottom cording. And 2 out of the 3 people both said yes, so I went with it. And then this is going to go around here. I need to grab my little scissors to bleed the cording out of the fabric. Let's go ahead and cut that open. I don't know if there's no easy way to position this so you guys can see this, but I'm just opening the seam on the cording so that I can cut the cord out of the inside. So I don't know if any of you that are members, because I know some of you are members that are watching, have had a chance to check out the new video that we just put up on the site. It is a rolled arm video. So it's the, if you saw a couple weeks back, whoops, we did the channel back chair that had a green paisley, and it's that arm. So the front of it is a roll on the front of the arm, and then the top is a flat surface like a panel. So that video is now up on the membership for everybody to see. All right, I'm going to fold that back, cut off this excess. Fold it back underneath itself and get that stapled. And there you can see the end of that. So the cording goes right up to the back, but doesn't go around the back. Do the same thing on this end. We are actually going to be adding some cornice board videos on our website for sale here before too long.
Did you answer Bob's question?
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't see Bob's question. What workshops are you doing at CWC this year? So at CWC, they're classes, they're lecture classes. They're not workshops. And I am doing a chair upholstery and a headboard upholstery class at CWC. Are you going to be there this year, Bob? Yeah, our workshops are the hands-on events I do. And conferences are, they're more of a lecture style rather than a hands-on. So it's a lecture. All right, so I did the same thing. Led the fabric or the cording out of the fabric. Go ahead and cut the excess off. Staples on the end of your scissor are never a good thing. Get rid of those. Scissors, for some reason, sometimes seem to become magnetic and they grab staples. I've got to take out a couple staples here because I came too close to the end to tuck that under. Actually, just one staple should do it. Okay, so Patty is asking, what is the preferred choice of wood for a cornice? We use plywood for the face of the cornice, and then we use one bys for the legs and the dust cap or dust board. So the dust cap and the legs are just number two pine, and you use whatever size depending on the projection you want. These were 1x3s, Bill?
Yeah.
Or 1x4s. Okay, these were 1x4s. Why a 4-inch board is, you know, a 1x4 is a 3.5-inch finished. I'll never know. I don't know what they were thinking when they designed the lumber cuts. But so, yeah, so these are 1x4s pine. And then the top is, or the face is plywood. And it's a 1/2-inch plywood. If you've got something, you know, really heavy, really long and heavy, I've seen people use 1/4-inch. So it just really depends on what you're working on. There are people that use, and you guys are going to need to help me out there watching. What is that product from Rolly that you get that you use cornice boards, make cornice boards out of?
No,
it's somebody posted out there. Fiberflex, maybe?
Yeah.
Fiberflex board. So it's kind of like a styrofoam. We actually have a piece, but I don't know where it is right this second to grab it. I know oftentimes people in the window treatment industry use, and it's much lighter weight when you're doing installs and things, but I prefer plywood for ours. So, all right, so now I have my decorative cording along the bottom, and I'm going to trim some of this fabric so I can see what I'm doing here. That's true. We've actually made them out of Luon before too, but I would not suggest Luon for something like this where I'm going to be doing a lot of stapling on the face of this cornice. So if you're just putting, you know, if you've just got one fabric that you're putting over this and you're padding, you know, the thinner plywoods are better or just as well or easy to use because you're not stapling into them. This is going to get a lot of staples in the front and you'll see why before too long. So now what we need to do is so if you're using Luon or a thinner plywood, you want to make sure you use the 1/4-inch staples. I'm using the 3/8-inch, I believe is what I've got in my hand today. Yeah, 3/8-inch staples. And at one point, I'm going to see if the 9/16 will be okay when I get to the thick areas. And they will when I've got to the areas where I'm going through multiple stuff. I'll be using the longer ones probably. So now what I need to do is get my next piece of fabric and cut off a new piece of cardboard tack strip since I wrecked one. So let me just grab that.
Firmaflex.
Thank you, Annette. Yeah, I knew what I said didn't sound right. Yeah, I have never used it, but I do have some on hand to try. I've never used it for cornice boards.
Everybody knew what it was except for you.
Yeah, everybody but me knew what it was because they're all window treatment. They don't come from the upholstery end.
Hey, Scott.
Yeah. Hey, Scott. And Sandra, and hello, Deborah. So, Scott, remind me, because I line my cornice boards before I put it together. Is it you that taught that class? I can't remember who I learned that from, but I do like that method. Scott does some beautiful cornice boards. All right, so now I am going to... So this is kind of like if you've upholstered a piece of furniture, if you've done a chair or a sofa that has arms and you've had straight outside arms, you've done this method for that. So this is where I flip the fabric forward, staple it to the top of the cording, Put my cardboard tack strip on it to give myself a nice square edge. And then I pat it and pull it up and around. So the way I'm doing this, you don't have to come back and finish off anything on this inside. All of your staples are hidden underneath your dust cap. So you don't have to do any top decorative things. So that's why I do it this way. But like I mentioned, if you're doing a curved bottom, you're not going to use this method. This is going to be different for a curved bottom. All right, so as you can see, I've got plenty of excess here because I just went and cut the full width, which I didn't need. So I'm going to go ahead and get this started. Why don't I turn this to make my life easier rather than fighting with this? All right. And get stuff out of my way. All right, so I'm just stapling right now on top of the seam allowance from my cording. If I can get my fabric to hold still for me. And I'm just gonna go and get some staples all the way across. And I know I cut this piece plenty big enough. I know the staple gun must be pretty loud here. It's echoing through the box because it's hollow. That's actually, when I get to the curvies, Bill, I may need something to brace underneath here. Do we have a piece of, even just a piece of the 1x4 would work. And there goes the air compressor. Of course, the air compressor had to turn on the time he needed to go through the door to grab me something, right? So it could be even louder for you guys. So, all right, so now, once I get the cardboard on here, this is going to flip up and go around to the top of my cornice. And I'm just double checking everything before I go ahead and put that all in there, because once that's all attached, I don't want to have to take it out again. But I think that cording on the bottom is going to look pretty snazzy, don't you? And we're also going to have cording, the green cording, following the diamond pattern. So,
see if that fits.
Yeah, that'll be good. Yep. All right, so now I can pull this back down. And I'm going to go ahead and trim some off this edge because I don't need all this hanging in my way. Get that out of the way. All right, so now. The overhead camera is not wanting to focus on this fabric. Okay, so he said the cornice, so Scott says the cornice class he taught years ago, he showed that method. I think the class I took with you where you did this was in Sturbridge, Mass, or Auburn, Mass, right around there. I can't remember the name of the workroom it was in, but I like that the best. I really enjoy doing it that way. Okay, now when I'm doing this, I am pushing that cardboard tack strip right up tight against my cording. So move this a little bit more so you can see. I think I already need this underneath there. I can feel it wanting to push in. Oops. I just broke my cardboard. But that's okay, I can piece it together. Staples over here on the end. And I need ammo. There. So now our cardboard tack strip is attached all the way around the perimeter of this. And if we pull this back, you can see that gives us a nice crisp edge when I pull that fabric down and shows off that green cording really well. So now we're going to pad the areas that are going to not have the next treatment over the top of them. So let me pull this back. So Christine Dickman says, windows, would you make a continuous box or three separate? I prefer personally making the three separate just because of the transportation and the ease for the installer. But you can also hinge them together. You could still make them as three separate and hinge them, or you could make them so that the face is one continuous fabric and still in three parts and hinge them. We don't do a lot of that in this area, so I haven't done too many. But to me, the all-in-one piece, is, and I have done it, the all-in-one piece unit is just so cumbersome to deal with that I prefer to do it in three parts. But I bet Scott might have a totally different answer to that question. So Scott, what would you do? Three pieces or one big cornice? I would be willing to bet that Sandra would probably do one big cornice after seeing the banquette she just did. All right, so now what I need to do is I need to put Dacron in this area and this area, and it's also got to go around the edges as well. So I don't know which camera I'm on here. So you can see that I've got to put Dacron in this area and not in this part or this part at this point, because we will add that later. So let me see, I had these pieces to get started, and we'll cut them down to follow the shape. And that's why I did the black Sharpie too, so I could kind of see beneath the Dacron to trim that off easier. And then I'll just add little pieces on these edges that come around the side. I don't need that to be continuous. So I'm going to go ahead and get this stapled on top of my cardboard. And I'm going in between the layers of the Dacron so I get a smoother finish. I don't get that little bump from the staple. And now following my black line, I am going to go ahead and trim that down. And again, I'm catching staples. Actually, I don't see it through as clearly as I thought I would. So we'll just trim and check. How's that? Oh, not too bad. I stayed pretty close to that line. So now I'm going to trim the other section. I don't know if you can see that I'm just following that black Sharpie line. And I'm going to stop in the center because I don't want any Dacron right in the middle of this area. And then I'll do a second piece up top, and then we'll add in those two little pieces. Now, I don't know if you saw the other day the little video we did. Did you put that video out there yet, Bill? Or maybe you didn't put it out there. We've got a project coming up. Let me just push this aside and show you because this is going to be fun. So we have a member of our online classes, and his name is Gary Love, and he does these little child-sized chair frames. So isn't this the cutest little thing? So we're going to be doing this as soon as the cornice board's done. This will probably be the next project that we do, is this cute little chair. And I happen to have a couple of granddaughters, so they might love these chairs. But yeah, he did this frame for us. I don't know if he sells them as knockdowns or not, or as bare frames, but we got him to sell us one. And he sells them upholstered for clients, though. But I thought it was just so cute, so we had to get one. We're always trying to look for different projects to do on our live, you know, something out of the ordinary or something we can have some fun with. But speaking of having some fun with this week, not this weekend, but next weekend, we have our first Ottoman class that I've done here is going to be on the 4th. And the students are starting to submit the Ottomans that they want to work on. So it's going to be fun. We've got some different sizes. Everybody's picking a different size. We got one woman who's tufting hers. So it'll be a fun class. I'm looking forward to that. And then we have another class this spring here at the end of March, which is another one of my small chair workshops. They're filling up quickly, but there's still a little bit of room. And then in April, I get to head to Georgia. So what kind of flowers will be blooming in Georgia by April? That'll be fun. So those are the exciting things I have coming up. So I'm going to cut this little point off because, like I said, I want to leave that hole open. And I'm just going to attach the edges of my date crown, and then I'll put the other piece up here and my little pieces on the side. So there's that, and I can get my two little pieces, I believe, out of this. So this will get me my two little ends. Not much waste, huh? That was pretty good. Oh, there's another piece of triangle hanging around here somewhere. So I'm going to go ahead and staple this. And I'm just stapling this the same way I did here, right on top of the cardboard tack strip. Now, I also want to let people out there that are members that are watching, we will not be live in our hangout for our members tomorrow. But we will be live on Friday instead at 12:30 Eastern Standard Time to the group. So those of you that are in our group, don't look for me tomorrow. I will be out of town at a funeral, but we will be live on Friday in the group. We generally do Thursdays, but sometimes things happen. And you just can't do it. So, all right, get this one in, and then we'll do the other side. So I can't believe that it's almost 1:30 already. So has anybody got any cornice boards coming up in the near future that they're working on? I'm hoping there wasn't just a staple stuck in that I was trying to cut. All right, so I got my two pieces in the end. A couple more staples to hold that little smidge of date crown down, spin it around. Trim this little piece of, everything catches on you. Trim this little piece of fabric that's hanging in the way. And I know you can't see this, but there's just no easy way to do this and have you see this section. But you know what I'm doing. All right, so now we have the date crown in the bottom, and I'm gonna go ahead and get the date crown in the top. We had a few more minutes, I can do it. And then the fabric will be pulled up and attached to the top of the cornice. And then next week, we'll add in the fun designs that we're going to be working with. All right, so let's get this on here. So as you can figure out, I'm sure, I decided to do those two diamond pieces are going to be this fun fabric. And I played around with the fabric because you could, if you did it, there's two different directions I could have done it in, and it got a totally different look each way. This way we end up with some really curvy lines. This will be what's set into those triangular pieces on the side next week. So isn't that fun? This is definitely a colorful cornice. Okay, trim. Yeah, one side down. And again, I'm just following that Sharpie line that I drew earlier. And I really thought I'd be able to see the Sharpie through the date crown, but it didn't work out that way. Cut off my little point because I need that center open up. My cameraman's dancing to tell me which camera to go to. That one now, Bill? Is that the one they're on? Sometime we got to get Bill on film behind the camera because he's over there going, that one. We need some sort of a light that flashes that says, Kim, look over here. Or maybe we need a headset so Bill can say to me, go to camera two. So So all I'm doing now is just putting a few staples in there to anchor that so that it won't shift. And again, I've got small pieces left here that I can get my ends out of. Oops, I didn't cut that very straight, did I? Which means this side's not very straight either. So Jane says, I am just starting cornice crowns for Hockey Brothers. They will have their number appliques and real hockey. Oh, that's really interesting. You got to share that one. I want to see that. So you're incorporating hockey sticks into the crowns. This camera? If I'm looking away from you guys, it's not because I don't want to talk to you. So that's interesting. I would love to see that when you're done. It's fun when you've got clients that want to do neat things like that. We did years ago, we did a valance, and I can't think of the name of the pattern. It was one of Pate Meadow's patterns, and it was a valance that you attached to the front of a board. It was a soft valance attached to a board that flipped over onto itself. So it kind of had a cuff at the top, and it had little medallions on the pattern that they showed. But my client wanted it for... Was it pennants? Oh, yes, it did. Okay, and it had pennants that hung underneath it. But no, not that one. That's not the one, I don't think. But anyway, so the one for Pate Meadows, she had little medallions that she had used at these specific points in the valance. And my client, we were doing it for a clubhouse, which was where they had their tennis courts and things. So we ended up using white antique tennis balls. Instead of medallions at each of these points. I'll see, I have to see if I can find a picture. It's probably somewhere in our photos here on Facebook. But that was a fun, you know, out of the box project using the white tennis balls. And I tell you, try to find antique white tennis balls. How many did we have to buy, Bill? That was a...
I think I ended up buying 100.
Yeah, I think we had to buy 100. And the client was like, whatever, buy them. But there was, I forget how many windows were in this room. There must have been at least 8 windows in this room that all had, you know, several tennis balls on each window. So it was pretty cool, though. This one's a little longer. There we go. All right, let's see if I can cut this edge a little straighter than I did last time. There we go. I just figured it was easier to piece in these little pieces on the end rather than having to waste, you know, that much extra on the side here. I knew I would have the little scraps out of what I was doing, so. But you wouldn't have to do this as piece if you didn't want to. Could have done it as one long continuous. So there, let's hold this up so you can get a look at it. So there is our dacron all on our cornice board, and now what we're going to be doing is pulling this fabric up and stapling it to the top before we add the second layer. But believe it or not, it is already 1:30 and it is time to say goodbye to you guys. So I thank you for spending this hour with us here on Facebook, and sorry we got to a rough start in the beginning and didn't get on immediately at 12:30, but technology plays games even once in a while. But thank you for joining us, and thank you for spending this hour with us. I really appreciate you spending time. And remind those of you that are in our private group that we will not be live tomorrow, but I'll see you guys on Friday at 12:30 with your questions. I don't have a lot of questions in the group right now, so go ahead and type in some questions for me so we can compile those and answer them for you live on camera on Friday at 12:30. But to the rest of you, thanks, and have a great rest of your week. And come back next Wednesday at 12:30 right here on our Facebook page where we will continue on this fun cornice board. So thanks, everybody, and have a great afternoon. I won't staple it down, but I'm just going to pull it back.